I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Tobias Wells' neo-Gothic tale of small-town terror. A die in the country. Starring Peter Marshall. Susan Strasberg. And Andrew Duggan. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Quaker State Motor Oil, Camphophonique, and Bayer Aspirin. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
In this, our mobile society, the act of physically moving one's family from one town to another is a relatively simple matter. The problem is leaving old friends behind and making new ones. Detective Newt Severson and his wife Brenda, having recently moved from Boston to the small suburban town of Wellesley, have begun making those new friends. However, they find themselves becoming more deeply involved in a web of intrigue and violence among their neighbors. While on an innocent errand to return a lost dog to their next-door neighbor, Mercy Bird, Newt has come upon startling evidence which tends to incriminate still another of their new Wellesley friends. City living was never quite like this. A Die in the Country resumes after this word.
All I had meant to do was let the dog in. But I found scissors, glue, and three words cut from old newspapers to make a bitter accusation. It was murder. So, Mercy Bird was the sender of the poison pen letters being received by Rudolph Wharton.
Newt. What are you doing in here?
I found Algernon.
It looks as if that's not all you found.
Why, Mercy? Why have you been sending these letters to Rudolph Wharton?
Because it's true. The man murdered his wife.
What makes you even think that?
I don't think it. I know it. Don't ask me how. I just do.
Then you've no evidence, no proof.
Not the kind you mean. But I know the kind of man Rudolph Wharton is, and I know the kind of person Ernestine Mayhew was. She wouldn't just go away like that. He killed her, I tell you.
Mercy, making such a terrible accusation against the man with no proof is going to land you in serious trouble.
Why doesn't somebody look for proof? If a man like Wharton wanted to get rid of a body, he'd find a way. Has anybody dug up his cellar, unlocked his trunks, examined his flower bed?
Mercy, you've been writing too many mystery stories.
You're a detective, aren't you? You know damn well murders are committed and bodies are hidden all the time. The only difference is nobody's looking for this one.
Nobody is looking for Ernestine Mayhew's body because the woman is alive and well, living with her sister in California. Chief Torrance has a letter from her, and he also talked to her on the telephone.
Oh, then the police do suspect something.
No. They acted on those letters, of course, to prove they were a hoax.
A hoax? That's exactly what Rudolph Wharton is pulling off. Don't you see?
See what?
Of course. You don't know about Ernestine and her sister.
What about them?
That they look and sound so much alike. Could almost be twins, those two. How better was Eulalie that the chief got the letter from and talked to on the telephone?
That might work for one of your books, but how could Rudolph Wharton persuade Eulalie Mayhew to masquerade as her sister? Then she'd know that he had killed her.
Perhaps she does know.
And is just going along with it?
There's something else you don't know about the Mayhew sisters. They were both in love with Rudolph Wharton.
Oh, Newt, you're not going to the police about Mercy, are you?
Honey, I have to do something. This kind of thing just can't be ignored.
You don't suppose that there's a chance she's right about Rudolph Wharton?
That he's a murderer? Huh. Now who's looking at our neighbors like a cop?
But why would Mercy do this?
Well, we know she's a little eccentric, and I suppose as a mystery writer, she may be inclined to let her imagination run amok.
Living all alone in that creepy house.
You know, there's hardly any furniture inside. I mean, from what I could see.
Keeping her mother in that rest home must have been very expensive.
Yeah. And a rest home owned by the rich Rudolph Wharton, no less.
But she shouldn't be put in jail just for harboring a grudge.
Sending threatening letters is more than just harboring a grudge. It's all going to depend on Wharton. I mean, what he wants to do about it after he finds out it's Mercy. Maybe he'll be charitable and not press charges.
Are you going to talk to him or the police?
I don't know. There's some sniffing around I want to do first.
Oh, darling. If anybody can help Mercy, you can. I think I'm glad I'm married to a bulldog after all.
My first stop was the town clerk's office in Town Hall, a redstone castle on top of a hill. I didn't think it wise to chance Rudolph Wharton's finding out that I'd been checking for information on his wife. So I made up a story to tell the clerk that wangled me a look at the alphabetical file under M. It took only a quick flip of the cards for me to get what I'd come for. Eulalie Mayhew's present address in California, where ostensibly both sisters could be found. My next stop was the public library. With luck, in a small town like this, I'd find copies of the Wellesley High School annuals there. I did. Should be the 40s, I figured. And I was right. The summer class of 1941 for Ernestine, 42 for Eulalie. I placed the pictures of the two sisters side by side. Heart-shaped faces, light eyes, identical blonde hairdos of the pompadour and pageboy style of the time. Even looking closely at them as I was doing, it was hard to see the difference between them. But did they sound alike as well, I wondered. I got a telephone number for Eulalie Mayhew from the long-distance operator. Riverside, California. Information. Miss Mayhew?
Yes.
Is this Miss Eulalie Mayhew?
Yes, it is. Who's this?
Hi, Lester Martin, Wellesley High, class of 41. Do you remember me?
I don't believe I knew you. I didn't graduate until a year after that.
Oh, I know. Your sister Ernestine was in my class. I understand she's staying there with you right now. Is that right?
Yes, she is.
Well, it's Ernestine I really called to talk to. It's quite important. Is she there?
Yes, she's here. Just a moment. Hello?
Eulalie?
No. This is Ernestine.
Ernestine Mayhew. How are you? This is Lester Martin. Long time no see.
Yes, my sister told me you were on the phone. I'm afraid it's been longer than I'd care to admit.
I'll bet you're wondering why I called.
Well, to be honest, I don't have the faintest notion.
Well, we're planning a class reunion. Thanksgiving Day, the old football rivalry, you know. It'll be a real homecoming. Can you make it?
Well, I don't know. I've been thinking of perhaps making a trip abroad soon.
Oh?
Who else is going to be at the reunion?
Oh, Clarence Masters, Nella Mawinney. I was given only the M's to call, so I don't know about the others.
Then you wouldn't know if Patsy Oliver is coming.
Patsy? No, she's not on my list.
I'll have to think about it.
I'll send you a letter with all the details, just as soon as they're worked out, of course.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Ernestine. Nice talking to you. And you know something?
What?
You and your sister sure sound exactly alike.
Well, you must have forgotten, Lester. We always did.
My phone call to California gave me nothing to go on. But for some reason, I suddenly thought of an old friend in Los Angeles. A private gumshoe named Jess Dyer, who I knew would do me a favor. A little stakeout at the Mayhew house, and maybe some discreet checking with the neighbors. Meanwhile, I decided to drop in for another little off-the-cuff chat with Chief Torrance down at the Wellesley police station. I was wondering, when you talked to Mrs. Wharton, what did you ask her? Did you find out when exactly she left Wellesley and how she got to California? Anything like that?
Well, I didn't interrogate her, if that's what you mean. No reason to. All I needed to know was that she was alive.
I suppose so. Only...
What are you getting at, Severson? I hope you don't have the idea that I didn't check thoroughly just because it was Wharton.
No. I wasn't thinking that.
There have been people in this town from time to time who've tried to buy me, but they've learned quick enough that I'm not their boy.
I can tell that.
Okay, I just wanted to set things straight, in case. Because I'm getting the notion that you've got an itch.
An itch?
That's what I call it when it happens to me. An itch I can't scratch keeps me up night sometimes. A feeling that something's out of kilter, off the mark.
Yeah. I guess maybe that's what I got.
And I gather you're thinking maybe it's a place I can reach that you can.
Maybe it is. What can you tell me about the Mayhew sisters, for instance? I hear they look and sound a lot alike.
Well, that's true enough, especially in their younger days when they dressed alike, wore their hair the same way and everything. Later on, they didn't do that anymore, of course.
I also hear that at one time, at least, they were both in love with Rudolph Wharton.
Yeah, I suppose they were. That'd be back in their younger days, too, before Wharton settled on Ernestine. I remember when my wife and I used to go to the steakhouse in those days. We'd see the three of them, young Wharton, as handsome then as he is now, with the Mayhew girls, one on each arm. Both of them looking up at him like he was God.
Is there anybody in town, anybody you can think of that Ernestine Mayhew would be likely to keep in touch with, no matter where she is?
Yep, one person. Constance Giordi. Taught both the Mayhew girls, but Ernestine apparently always felt something special for her. She's the first person I tried to check when Wharton started getting those letters.
And?
You notice I said tried. I asked her if she heard from Ernestine, and all she said was, wherever Ernestine was Ernestine's own business, and I should mind my own.
Where does she live?
Over in Back Bay on Oak Street in a little house Ernestine gave her, scot-free. She's the one to talk to about Ernestine, all right. But I don't envy you trying.
I caught a faint movement of the lace curtain across the glass panel door. And I rang again.
Go away, whoever you are.
I'm not going to, Miss Giordi. I need to see you.
Who are you, anyway? I never saw you before.
I know. I haven't lived here in Wellesley long. I'm a detective from Boston, and I want to speak to you about Ernestine. Ernestine Mayhew?
I just want to know one thing from you, whoever you are. Is Ernestine in any kind of trouble?
I don't know. That's what I want to talk to you about.
Well, then come in. Whatever it isn't any business of the neighbors.
I stepped inside into a room that smelled of oriental rugs and furniture polish. Constance Giordi peered into my face with eyes like a pair of shiny black marbles.
In the first place, you haven't even told me your name.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's Severson. Newt Severson? My wife and I moved here recently. Our house is directly across the street from Rudolph Wharton. Miss Giordi... Do you have any way of knowing that Ernestine Mayhew is all right?
All right? What do you mean by that?
If you could tell me that you've heard from her,
but
then...
But I can't tell you that, Mr. Severson, because I haven't. Not a word.
Isn't that unusual? I'm told you're the one she's most likely to be in touch with.
If she chose to, but there's no reason she should.
But doesn't it seem strange to you that she apparently left town without telling anyone that she was leaving?
Oh, but she didn't do that, Mr. Severson. She told me.
She did?
Of course. She telephoned and told me she was leaving Rudolph Wharton at last. Well, I told her, good riddance. I hoped she'd leave him the way she found him, without a penny.
Then Ernestine knew of your dislike for her husband.
Oh, naturally. I spoke against the man from the first moment she and Eulalie took up with him.
Eulalie was in love with him, too?
And I told Ernestine she should let Eulalie have him. Eulalie would have been a better match for him. She wouldn't have let the man walk all over her the way Ernestine allowed him to.
Then Ernestine and Eulalie were not as alike as they appear to be in the photographs?
Well, they only looked alike.
And sounded alike?
Well, yes, that was strange. One might swear that their voices were identical.
Then someone might talk to one of them on the telephone and not be certain whether it was Ernestine or her sister.
Yes, that's true.
In that case, Miss Giordi, the only evidence we have that Ernestine Mayhew is safely in California is this letter. Keith Torrance received it in answer to his inquiry.
Mr. Severson... This letter was not written by Ernestine Mayhew.
It wasn't? Are you sure?
I'm positive. Now, even I couldn't always tell them apart by their appearance. Often, I'd have to look to see which one of them was speaking. But as their school teacher, I learned to distinguish their handwriting. I am positive. This letter was written by Eulalie Mayhew.
I felt a chill when the old woman told me with such certainty that the letter had not been written by Ernestine, but by her sister. Maybe Mercy Bird, with all her talk of murder, wasn't so far off base after all. But I knew about handwriting evidence in court. One expert verified a forgery, a second expert repudiated the testimony of the first. Although I wondered who would dare to repudiate Constance Giordi. I was in the mood now to have that chat with Rudolph Wharton regarding Mercy's imprudent, threatening notes. I had a feeling I was going to find Wharton inclined to be lenient. I found him in his office in a building that housed a bank, a pharmacy, and a department store, all belonging to Wharton, I presumed. He sounded even more tolerant than I'd expected.
Poor Mercy. She never quite got over her mother's death. They were very close.
Yes, I gather that.
She blames me for it, as perhaps she's told you. You know, I've always thought that strange. It's natural enough to blame someone, the doctor of the fates, but just because I happen to own the nursing home?
Yes, that must be the reason for her sending you those letters. But why do you suppose she would accuse you of killing your wife?
Well, she's always been fond of Ernestine, I think. Ernestine tolerated her. I suppose somehow she associated my wife's departure with the death of her mother. Two people she was fond of.
Yes. I guess that's possible.
She's inclined to be eccentric, as I'm sure you've noticed. Eccentric is putting it kindly.
She's something of a character, all right.
But harmless enough, I imagine.
Then, are you going to press charges against her?
No, I don't think that'll be necessary.
That's very generous of you, considering the harassment she's caused you.
Well, perhaps it might be well for her to see a psychiatrist. There's a good man at the hospital I could refer her to.
I doubt that she has the money for that kind of treatment.
Well, something could be worked out, I'm sure.
Thank you, Mr. Wharton. You're being most considerate. I'm glad. As a matter of fact, my wife and I have become quite fond of Mercy Bird, and I wouldn't want to see her in any real trouble.
By the way, Mr. Severson, I've had a call from my wife.
You have?
Yes. She was puzzling over a phone call she received. The caller identified himself as someone who'd been in high school with her, and he invited her to a class reunion.
What's puzzling about that? Someone's always trying to get up a high school class reunion.
Of course, but then she asked the man if Patsy Oliver was coming, and he answered that he didn't know because she wasn't on the list.
What's wrong with that?
Well, Patsy Oliver was a very popular figure at Wellesley High in those years. I remember him well. Patsy was a nickname for Patrick.
Oh. Well, I tell your wife not to worry. Memory plays tricks on people. We all know that. Don't we, Mr. Wharton? I wasn't worried about that little blunder I'd made. I was only wondering what kind of call Rudolph Wharton had really received. Leaving Wharton's office, I threw caution out of the window by walking into the bank and making an inquiry about Ernestine Mayhew Wharton's account. I showed my Boston ID card, and after a long moment's hesitation, the bank official obliged.
Well, yes, Mrs. Wharton has an account with us.
A separate account of her own?
That's right.
I need to know what withdrawals Mrs. Wharton has made since January of this year.
Oh, well, just a moment. That I'll have to check.
You understand, of course, sir, this inquiry must be kept entirely confidential.
Yes. Yes, of course. Just a moment.
He picked up a telephone, and I wondered if he was checking with a bookkeeper or with Wharton.
Mr. Severson.
Yes.
I must say it does seem rather odd, but Mrs. Wharton has made no withdrawals at all from her account since January.
Chief Torrance wasn't going to like it. But I figured it was time for us to have another little talk. I was right. He didn't like it.
Damn it, Severson. I don't need this can of worms. I don't need it at all.
I can understand your position.
And it seems to me everything you've dug up is still pure speculation.
Even Constance Giordi's statement? She told me she'd swear on her family Bible that your letter ostensibly from Ernestine was actually written by Eulalie.
that's the one thing I can't ignore. I'll give you that.
Then the reasonable doubt is now on the side of Mercy Bird, don't you think?
I suppose once you allow yourself to even consider the possibility of murder, town selectman notwithstanding, you've... Very well, Severson, let's assume that we have a case and get on it.
Yes, sir.
Here's something to start with. After you brought up the subject, I checked out the passenger list on the flights out of Boston at the time of Ernestine Wharton's assumed departure.
And?
And E. Wharton flew out of Boston bound for Los Angeles on January 10th. If it wasn't Ernestine, it was somebody else.
Eulalie.
Yeah. Well, considering we're going along with this whole assumption, I suppose it could have been, although you'd think somebody around Wellesley would have seen her while she was here.
They might have and thought it was Ernestine. If Eulalie were deliberately assuming her sister's identity.
All right. And what we want to find out is, if there was a flight into Boston from L.A. sometime just before the 10th that shows an E. Mayhew on the passenger list.
Exactly.
Yes. I'll put it through. Call for you, Severson.
My wife, I told her I'd be here. You see, our baby's due any time now.
Then get on this phone, man, for heaven's sake.
Hello. Hi, Brenda. Are you all right? When? I'll be right home. It wasn't our baby, it was yours.
Mine?
You can forget Greg Farley. Your obscene caller's still on the loose. He just called my wife.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, A Die in the Country. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. All that the Serversons wanted was to move away from Boston to a quiet little house in the country. And that's precisely what they did. However, there were a great many unexpected bonuses thrown into the bargain. Threatening letters, obscene phone calls, wife-swapping neighbors, a strange disappearance, and an accusation of murder. As Detective Newt Severson, with the reluctant cooperation of Wellesley Police Chief Torrance, presses for an investigation into the affairs of town selectman Rudolph Wharton, Wellesley's elusive, obscene telephone caller strikes again. This time with a call to Severson's young wife, Brenda, while she's home alone, awaiting the impending birth of their first child. For Newt Severson, life in the country is about to explode and reverberate down to the very foundation of his existence. In a moment, the conclusion of A Die in the Country. But first, this word.
I was furious with myself for not being home with Brenda at this crucial stage of her pregnancy. I was just caught up in this Wharton business, so when Brenda got that crank phone call, it just set me off. Never mind Rudolph Wharton and whether or not he did or didn't murder his wife. Let's get this damn phone freak out of circulation.
Calm down, Severson. Just get on home to your wife. We're working on this telephone business.
There's one thing, Chief. This puts young Farley in the clear about everything except that car theft charge.
And he can probably be released to the custody of his parents pending his arraignment. They want it that way.
I think maybe they will. I'll get back to you on the Wharton case as soon as I'm satisfied my wife feels okay.
And I'll get on the airline's angle meanwhile. Oh, but will you do me a favor, Severson? Play this close until if and when we really have something.
Yeah, I know. Wait a minute. This call to Brenda gives us something new on the phone nut.
What's that?
He didn't work from the Wellesley directory this time. We're not in it.
He must have gotten it from information.
No, he couldn't have. We have an unlisted number.
That's what I've been wondering, too, Newt. How did he get our number?
Did he address you by name?
Yes, right away. He said, "Hello, Mrs. Severson."
But you didn't recognize the voice at all?
No. It was deep and, sort of suave sounding.
Yeah, Dolly Celine called it sexy.
Oh, well, I'm not Dolly Celine. I would have hung up on him right away, but I knew you'd want me to find out everything I could.
Thanks, but I hope you didn't stick with that nut too long.
I couldn't. It was just, it was too much. I had to hang up.
What time was this? Just before you called me?
Yes, about 4:30.
Later than usual for him.
I just wish I knew how he got our number.
So do I. If we knew that, it might tell us who he is. The thing to do is make a list of everybody who knows our number or anybody who's been inside the house where they could have seen it on the phone.
That could have been, even any of the workmen who've been here.
Exactly.
Even that sweet little old man who hung our new wallpaper?
Darling, I'm a suspicious cop, remember? That sweet little old man could very well have a sexy telephone voice. What a hornet's nest we'd found ourselves in with this innocent little move out into the country. Maybe Brenda was right. Other people seem to live out their lives without coming up against murder, robbery, assault, and heaven knows what. I was beginning to wonder myself, did the crime attract the cop, or did the cop attract the crime? It didn't matter. At the moment I considered myself on a possible murder case, and I figured by now my contact in California had had time enough to check out that house and its neighbors in Riverside. Yes, it's Newt. Find out anything for me?
I don't know, but for what it's worth, here's the rundown. The neighbors don't seem to know anything about a sister, but then they say Eulalie Mayhew isn't much of the neighborly type.
You mean her sister could be there, and they wouldn't know it, huh?
That was the impression they gave me.
But none of them could say that they'd seen both sisters together?
No, I didn't get that from anybody, but for your information, at the moment, there's nobody living in the house.
What do you mean, nobody?
Whether there was one sister or two, they're not there now.
The next morning at headquarters, I passed Dyer's information on to Chief Torrance.
So, what do you think it means?
I'd like to find out from Wharton what it means, but I don't want to flush him out at this point.
Maybe Eulalie Mayhew has already flown the coop.
No, it wouldn't make sense. I mean, Wharton still needs her around, right? Oh, by the way, does Eulalie have any of her father's holdings?
No, Ernestine was the old man's favorite. Eulalie was left just with an annuity. More than adequate, I understand, but it was a definite slight.
That gives Eulalie a bit of a motive, too, doesn't it?
Oh, not for murder, I shouldn't think. But I suppose it could weaken her resistance against aiding and abetting.
Any luck on that check of the airlines?
Not yet. There's a chance she wouldn't have used her own name, of course. Yes? Oh, yes, of course. Tell him to come in. Wharton's on his way in. Mr. Wharton, how are you?
Hello, Chief. Severson, they told me you were in here, and I was hoping to talk to both of you.
Well, what's up, Mr. Wharton?
Well, for one thing, I've just learned that my wife has left the country.
Oh?
She's gone on an extended trip. I don't know for how long. Hawaii, the Orient, perhaps?
Around the world?
I don't know, Mr. Severson. My sister-in-law tells me she wasn't certain. In fact, Eulalie is quite concerned about Ernestine.
In what way?
Well, it seems our separation has been weighing heavily on her. She's been very depressed. And now, suddenly, she's just packed up and gone. Eulalie's quite distraught. Oh,
I'm sorry to hear that, Mr. Wharton. Any way we can be of help?
No, there's nothing even I can do. We're just hoping Ernestine will be in touch with one of us soon.
It wouldn't be too difficult to locate her, I imagine, if we get on it quickly enough.
No, I wouldn't want her to think I was keeping tabs on her. She wanted her freedom. I think maybe a trip is a good idea for her at this time.
Yeah, probably is.
Frankly, at the moment, it's Eulalie I'm concerned about. I didn't think she should be alone out there worrying about her sister, so I suggested that she come here, back to Wellesley for a while.
Well, now, it'll be nice to see Eulalie Mayhew again. You're going to enjoy meeting her, Severson. She's quite a woman.
Yes, I'd like very much to meet her.
You'll have the opportunity. That's why I'm here. You'll both come, won't you?
Come? Come where?
To my house, Saturday night. I'm throwing a little party for you, Lily, to welcome her home.
Brenda's only concern when I told her about Wharton's party was which of her maternity dresses looked the least like a maternity dress. My concern was that I have Dr. Abrams' number in my pocket. It would be just like our stubborn son and heir to put in his belated appearance just as I was closing in on a murder.
I wonder if he's invited any of the other neighbors.
Mercy Bird wouldn't come if he asked her.
Mercy's only come out of her house long enough to give Algernon a quick walk lately. She must be busy writing a new book.
As long as she's not writing any more letters.
What about the Farleys? Do you think they'll be there?
I doubt it. I gather the only neighborliness between the Whartons and the Farleys was Ernestine Wharton's friendship with young Greg.
It's a shame she isn't around to help him now.
Maybe not. Maybe his own parents will come through for him this time.
Is Greg still in jail?
No. His mother brought him home this afternoon.
Oh, Newt, doesn't it scare you? Pretty soon we're going to be parents.
I don't know. Junior is sure taking his time about getting here.
I don't blame him, considering all that's been going on.
Well, tell him to hold off at least a few more hours. I don't think Rudolph Wharton's cocktail party is going to be any place to have a baby. Saturday couldn't come fast enough for me. Call it my suspicious cop nature, but I was certain the party would be a showdown. I spent any free time I had at home nursing along the ivy I'd planted around the railing of our porch. I was hoping to catch a glimpse, a sneak preview of Eulalie Mayhew. But I never saw a sign of her, or Wharton for that matter. Finally...
Hello, Severson.
You know my wife?
Yes, of course. Good of you to join us, Mrs. Severson. Come in. I want you to meet Eulalie.
Before he had led us halfway across the room, I saw her. Shining silver gold hair, a flawless skin, glowing under a golden California suntan. Eyes the color of pansies, a young girl's body in a sleek gold cocktail dress. So, that was Eulalie Mayhew. I found myself wondering if Ernestine, wherever she was, still looked like her sister.
Ludi tells me you're a detective.
That's right.
Mr. Severson is with the Boston police, but it appears he's intrigued by our little transgressions in Wellesley as well. Which reminds me, I believe Chief Torrance has some news for you, Severson. He's right over there.
A detective? A police chief? Well, it appears Rudy has himself surrounded by the law. What a lovely outfit you have on, Mrs. Severson.
Thank you.
Will this be your first?
I left Brenda gazing enviously at Eulalie Mayhew's sylph-like figure and made my way across the room to see what Torrance had come up with. If it were the information we'd been after from the airlines, Wharton unwittingly may have just directed me toward his own undoing.
Oh, Severson, you'll want to hear this. Dennehy called in a little while ago with quite a piece of news.
Concerning our genial host?
Nah, not this time. It's the telephone nut. We've got him.
Hallelujah! Are you sure? I mean, how did you find him?
It was that list you had your wife make up that did it. You know, all the workmen who had been in your house since you moved in.
Now, don't tell me it was the sweet little old man who hung the wallpaper.
Nah, but you're close. Try the nice, clean-cut, all-American type who installed your telephone.
A guy from the telephone company? Why is it we never think of the obvious?
Seems he just kind of blends into the woodwork. Nobody pays any attention to him.
And once he's done his job, you forget he was there.
But when we went back and checked, we found him everywhere. When Dennehy moved in on him in a cruddy little apartment over in Needham, there it was. A little yellow Wellesley directory and a raft of porno junk all over the place.
Did he own up?
Through everything but the Dolly Saline attack, claims he never done any real harm to anyone. Just a talker, not a doer, according to him.
Do you buy that?
Dennehy does. He thinks the guy called her all right, but he never went near her.
But then, how do you explain...
I don't know. We're going to have another talk with Mrs. Saline.
Chief, here comes Dennehy now. What's he doing here?
I don't know, but he sure is in a hurry. I hope he doesn't knock anybody over. What is it, Dennehy?
That piece of information you've been waiting for just came in, Chief.
From the airline?
You really hit the nail on the head, Newt. On January 9th, just the day before an E. Wharton flew out of Boston, an E. Mayhew flew in from L.A.
Well, now, isn't that interesting? I think maybe our host will find it much more stimulating than the usual cocktail party conversation. I took pity on the chief and went to look for Wharton myself. I found him more or less where I expected, on the terrace in the shadows with a glint of gold lame beside him. Sorry to disturb you, Mr. Wharton, but something's come up about your wife.
Rudy.
What about my wife, Mrs. Severson?
The chief will explain. He and Dennehy are in the study. You can come too, Miss Mayhew, if you wish.
Yes, of course. Has anything happened to her?
I have the feeling we'll all have an answer to that very soon. Despite Eulalie Mayhew's involuntary gasp and her alarmed look of a cornered doe, Wharton remained as unruffled as ever. I went on ahead alone to the study. A few moments later, they followed me in. Dennehy looked nervous in his uniform. I felt like our cat mine hair out stalking prey. Chief Torrance was less ferocious, so I let him begin.
I'm sorry, Mr. Wharton, but several things have come up that we need to have explained.
Well, that's all right, Chief. I can understand your position. Well, what sort of things?
Well, for one, that letter we received from your wife confirming her whereabouts in California.
Well, what about it?
Well, we have it on good authority, very good authority, that it was not written by your wife at all.
Really?
That instead it was written by you, Eulalie.
By me? But I...
Never mind, Eulalie. You don't have to deny it. I'll explain.
Please do, Mr. Wharton.
As a matter of fact, Eulalie did write the letter at my request.
Why was that?
Because Ernestine refused to. As far as I was concerned, she didn't care if I rotted in hell.
You never indicated before that there was that much animosity between you and your wife, Wharton?
Because I wanted to spare Eulalie. You see, the truth is, my wife was insanely jealous of her sister.
Oh, that's something I never knew. Ernestine didn't seem the type.
Oh, well, it was only where I was concerned. She constantly made the accusation that it was Eulalie I really loved. Eulalie I should have married.
I see.
Mr. Wharton, there's something else. We know that on January 10th, someone under your wife's name boarded a plane out of Boston for Los Angeles.
That was my wife, Severson. Who else would it be?
Eulalie.
But Eulalie was in California at her house in Riverside.
No, she wasn't. We have the evidence that Eulalie came here to Wellesley on January 9th.
Rudy?
If she did, Detective Severson, I know nothing about it.
Rudy?
Were you here, Eulalie? You should have taken me into your confidence. I might have been able to help you out of this.
Rudy, what are you saying?
I knew, of course, how much resentment toward my wife Eulalie has always felt since their father died, leaving a will that favored Ernestine. But I never thought Eulalie could be capable of taking any kind of cold revenge on her sister.
That's not what happened.
Wharton, what are you trying to pull? You know very well Eulalie was here at the time of your wife's disappearance. It was at your request that she came.
But that's impossible. I had nothing to do with it. I wasn't even here in Wellesley myself at that time.
You weren't?
I was out of town, in Virginia, attending a golf tournament. And I can account for every moment of my
time. Look out, she's got my gun.
Rudy!
Rudy, put that down.
No. Oh, Rudy. Rudy. Why? I'm sorry.
It's all my fault, Chief. Get the door, Dennehy. Keep everybody out. I better call an ambulance, Newt.
No reason to. Wharton's dead. It was all in the Wellesley newspaper. It was on the front page for weeks. The gradual piecing together of the facts. Ernestine Wharton had told her husband she was divorcing him, reclaiming the titles to all of her properties and leaving him penniless. In a rage, Wharton had killed her. Killed her on the 7th of January. Greg Farley testified that he had spent most of January 6th in Ernestine Wharton's company. And January 8th was the day it was proven that Rudolph Wharton left Wellesley to attend the golf tournament in Virginia. Eulalie Mayhew arrived in Wellesley on the 9th. Not knowing that her sister was dead. She maintained this stance at the trial. She swore she hadn't known and never saw the body.
Oh, come now, Miss Mayhew. It certainly would be to your advantage to cooperate at this point and tell this court where the body of your sister, Ernestine Mayhew Wharton, lies buried.
I don't know, I tell you.
Remember, she was the victim of a cold, calculating murderer, Rudolph Wharton. Where is your poor sister now, Miss Mayhew?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know.
The trial went on and on, and the prosecution hammered away at Eulalie Mayhew about the location of her sister's body. The only thing in the next few weeks that was resolved was Brenda's condition. It was a 7-pound, 8-ounce boy.
Do you think Eulalie Mayhew's telling the truth, Newt?
Well, then he does. and he's become something of an authority on hysterical women ever since he broke down that story of Dolly Celine's.
Imagine. Deliberately hurtling herself down the stairs to fake an attack just for attention.
Gradually, Wellesley finally became the quiet little suburban town we thought it would be when we first moved in, before Minehare came scampering into the house that first night with a dead squirrel in his mouth. But, of course, as Mercy Bird reminded us daily, no one had yet discovered where Rudolph Wharton had hidden his wife's body. Then one day, Brenda had just coaxed the baby into taking his afternoon nap. I was out on the porch trimming the ivy that was threatening to take over the house when...
I got it! I got it!
Honey, here comes Mercy, and she's got it. Whatever it is.
I figured it out. I knew if I just kept working on it, I'd come up with the answer.
You mean you think you know where the body's buried?
I don't think I know. I know. Now listen to this. Wharton committed the murder on January 7th. On January 8th, I had the flu. It was a Friday. I remember it well. I just sat up in bed all day, looking out the window and watching the workmen.
Workmen?
Yeah, they had to delay digging earlier because the ground was frozen. But then there was an early thaw that first week in January, and they came and poured the cement that day, and I was watching them. January 8th. Now, Rudolph Wharton carried his wife's body away during the night of January 7th, put it in the hole, covered it with dirt and stones. And the next morning, the workman came and supplied a handy cement tomb.
What workman?
Yeah, Mercy. What are you talking about?
I'm talking about your house. Well, it's being remodeled before you moved in. You can take my word for it. I know where the body is. We're standing on it. Ernestine Mayhew is buried right here under your front porch.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
That concludes this week's production of The Zero Hour. Tobias Wells, a die in the country. Next week, we'll begin another exciting dramatization of a tale of mystery and suspense. We'll tell our story in 5 days, at the same time, Monday through Friday. So on Monday, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by State Farm Insurance, Wrigley Gum, and Delco Batteries. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.